is everyone ready? We can open the hearing. So I'm gonna call to order the regular virtual meeting for the Inland Wetlands Watercourse Commission for Wednesday, June 8th at 2022. It's now 7:10. First, and we do have a quorum. The record can reflect that we do have a quorum. First order of business is to approve the minutes of the April 13, 2022 regular meeting.
I move that we approve them.
Thank you, Aurel. May we have a second?
Second.
Second by Fred. I'm not going to do it the way David does it, because it's just easier for me to say all in favor.
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay, it carries. Minutes of May 11th, 2022. That's the second order of business. We need a motion to approve those.
So moved.
Thank you, Aurel. Second?
I'm going to have to abstain, but can I second?
You can second, absolutely. I have abstained as well. I wasn't at that meeting.
No, I wasn't either.
We're going to have enough people for this one tonight.
I was at this. I was in there.
You don't already get a... I guess between Nick and Aurel, you guys could do it, I guess.
We have a quorum, so it'll pass two abstentions. Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Did I have a second?
So Nick will second.
Nick, thank you, Nick. Any further discussion, modifications, et cetera, et cetera? All right. All in favor?
Aye.
That's two. Opposed? That's none. Abstentions?
Yeah.
And me. That's two. So it would pass. Two to nothing with two abstentions. I believe that's how it works.
Correct.
All right. Third on the agenda tonight is a permit request, 157 Loomis Street, a permit application to fill in a man-made pond within a regulated area. That's been continued to July
13, 2022? Correct.
Okay, so there's nothing we need to do on that.
Correct.
And that was continued at the applicant's request?
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
There's a letter in the packet.
Gotcha. Second, under agenda item number three, it pertains to a permit request at 31 Peck Orchard Road, a permit application to construct a single family home and associated improvements within a regulated area. Okay, do we have anyone representing the applicant on that permit request?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes. Who's speaking?
This is Guy Hesketh.
Okay, I see you now, guys. Thank you.
Good evening. For the record, I'm here this evening representing Adam Skoczuk, and with me is George Logan. He's the soil scientist that's working on the project. And together, between George and me, we prepared the plans and studies that you have before you for the application. With your permission, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to go and present the application. Is there a way that you can give me control of the screen so I can put some graphics up?
You're a co-host.
You're a co-host, I believe, is what Kate just said, if you didn't hear that. You have the floor, so go for it.
All right, let's see. How do I...
just share a screen at the bottom.
Let's see here. I don't have a share screen. Oh, here we go. Yeah, I got one right here. Let's see. All right, here we go. All right. Can you see the screen I've got up?
Correct. Yep.
Yep.
All right. So in the plan package we put together, we've got four drawings that are included that our office prepared, and then we've got the survey of record that's part of the package. I'll just go over these drawings real quickly. What you have in front of you in sheet SP-1 is the plot plan that's drawn at 40 scale that shows the proposed development lot, and not really a close-up view, but an overall view of the parcel and the development that's proposed. Plan north is to the right. That's the way we got the survey information, so that's the way we're presenting it. We've got on the bottom of the page, sort of from the lower left-hand corner towards the upper right-hand corner, is Peck Orchard Road. And as you're driving up the road, as you go up the hill, the lot is the last lot in the town of Granby. The dividing line between the Granby-Heartland town line is actually the western edge or western parcel boundary. The lot is going to be reconfigured. The existing lot is a smaller lot. It's going to be reconfigured by taking portions of number 25 Peck Orchard Road, which is owned by Linda Varco. She's got a deal with Adam to do a lot reconfiguration plan. So he'll end up with a total of 3.61 acres. And that's delineated, if you can see the hand going along here, there's the western boundary, the southern boundary, the eastern boundary, and then, of course, the northern boundary fronts on Peck Orchard Road. He's proposing a single-family home. Let me go to my next one here. Here's a close-up of the area of construction that's proposed on the lot. Peck Orchard Road, again, is on the bottom of the page, and I've got delineated where a proposed single-family home is proposed, and then a two-car detached garage will be part of the proposal. And then, of course, in this area here, it's required to have a septic field. We're locating a septic tank and a pump chamber in the area behind the home, and then a leach field would be located in the area closer towards Peck Orchard Road. Mr. Logan went out and he flagged the wetlands. This plan is a little different than the one you have as part of your package because it is colorized, but you can see over in this area here a double blue line which travels and pretty much splits a lot in two. That's Fox Brook. And that flows from the west direction and sort of a southeasterly direction through the parcel. And then associated with the brook itself are the wetlands, which define its, what Mr. Logan did was flag the eastern border of that wetland. And that's what's depicted in green. So you have the brook in blue, and in green you have the wetland flags and the delineations, and the flags are depicted on the plan. And those correspond to his wetlands report. So also on the plan, if you look, you'll see in purple, there's a line that's designated here, which goes around the home and skirts around this area. That's really related to an upland area for your zoning regulations. Your zoning regulations require that for a water course, a structure has to be located a minimum of 75 feet outside of the water course. So we show this because this plan will also go before the staff for a zoning permit for construction of the home. In the green dashed line I have here, this line represents the 100-foot upland review area to those delineated wetlands. And then the blue dashed line, which is further towards the east and east of the brook, it represents the 200-foot upland review area from the water course. So the blue water course, the blue upland review area, the green line delineating the wetlands, and the green upland review area for the wetlands. So this plan depicts the activities that occur within your regulated areas. And again, that would include a construction of the home, the septic components, the septic tank and the pump chamber, and then the garage structure, which is located here. The garage, the home, and a few components of the septic field are located within 100-foot upland review area. The septic leach field is located outside of the 100-foot upland review area, but within the 200-foot upland review area, because essentially the entire lot is within the 200-foot upland review area. So those are the activities that are proposed within your regulated area. We did explore, when we looked at the site, several options related to where the septic field could be located. So before we did that, we took a look at where the house would be located. And by locating it outside of the 75-foot zoning buffer to the water course, it really only left us with an area here in the flat area of the site, or another area which is along Peck Orchard Road, which is relatively steep. If you are familiar with that area, when you drive up Peck Orchard Road, you look off to the left, it's a pretty steep slope that comes down the edge of the property. The house really cannot feasibly be constructed on this slope because your regulations require a 50-foot front yard. That would put the house sort of down on the middle of the slope. It's really not a feasible or prudent area to locate the house. An interesting component of this lot also, if you see on the on this delineation I have here in the sort of burnt orange color, this represents a right-of-way to a former roadway that historically went through the parcel. That roadway is referred to as the former Jones Road right-of-way. That road was abandoned by the legislative process in the town several years ago. However, there's still an existing gravel, I don't know, for lack of a better term, might be a gravel logging road or something that runs through the site. We believe that there still may be rights to pass that exist for use of that logging road to the Connecticut DEEP as part of an access to a former access path to a state forest that were in the area. So do have the rights to construct in there. However, we believe in this abandonment of this right-of-way will actually become legally part of the parcel. So it's no longer a meets and bounds right-of-way, but we believe that there are prescriptive rights still that exist for use of this by the DEEP in Connecticut. So we've designed our driveway to basically follow along the same access of that gravel driveway, and we've located our structures outside of that area. Septic field, we did some exploration. We looked at places that would be feasible. One area would be over here in the vicinity and proximity to the house. Those soils were not too bad. It would support a system. But we found some better soils up here in the sandy soils that are on the hillside in this location here. We did some exploratory test pits in the presence of the Farmington Valley Health District, did some percolation testing. Soils look good. We've come up with a preliminary design that we've forwarded to the Farmington Valley Health District for their review. We believe this is the most feasible and prudent alternative for locating a septic field on the site because of the distance away from the wetlands and the nature of the soils. It's a very minimal impact, very low risk to the wetland resources. As far as sedimentation and erosion control that we're proposing during construction, you'll see a dark line with X's through it that's located here around the envelope of development for the home. That would be a silt fence erosion control, would be installed in this area and in this area here that are down gradient of the construction activities to trap any sediments, protect them from leaving the immediate construction area. We also are proposing a construction exit, which is the crushed stone apron that's put in for anti-tracking pad. And then any of the areas that are in any slopes that are steeper than a 4-to-1, we are proposing to use an erosion control blanket on those disturbances. You'll see the clearing limits on the plan. We propose to minimize the clearing of vegetation, just the immediate amount needed to construct the home and the leach fields. And that will significantly reduce any potential for sediment transport. But the house itself would be located here, graded so that it's fairly level with the roadway. The lot does drop off in this direction towards a brook. So the house will be amenable to putting in a walkout basement with walkout in the southwest portion of the house. So we won't be doing a lot of filling around the foundation, only in the back area here to support a transition between the home and the driveway and allow parking of cars in this area here, which is close to grade, and then taking advantage of the natural topography to allow, an elevated portion of the home that has a look that looks out over in the direction to the west, essentially. That's pretty much it for my presentation. There are no direct wetlands impacts to the proposal, and in my opinion, there's no adverse impacts to the resource areas. At this time, I'd like to turn the time over to George Logan to explain his wetlands delineation, and he did a review of the proposal and prepared an impact report. And then when he concludes, he certainly would be available to answer any questions that you may have. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You're welcome.
Good evening, everyone. My name is George Logan, Remo Ecological Services. I'll be as brief as possible because this is sort of a little bit of an introductory to the commission and their decision process. So wetland delineations were conducted at two different dates. Way back in July of 2021, I did most of the delineation. At that time, the configuration of the lot was a little different. So I thought I went far enough, but as it turned out, the lot configuration changed. So I returned in May and added a few flags, which followed the brook. And then, as you know, there's a man-made pond just down gradient or downstream. And so I had to sort of, where that opens, the brook comes into the pond, I had to sort of turn in a northerly direction and follow the fill slope or the man-made slope along the pond until it started turning away again. So the wetlands, obviously the major resource feature here is obviously Fox Brook. It does have a little bit of a floodplain, which it's not mapped out by the USDA and RCS mapping because is rather limited. So there are some floodplain soils along the brook that are poorly drained and maybe even very poorly drained in a couple of spots. And then, and maybe I could at some point show that to you, there's a little bump out that you probably saw from the stream that climbs up a couple of feet into what looks like an upland, but is actually probably a relic Marley Well drain floodplain soil. What happens in Connecticut very often is that as the brook starts getting more incised, it leaves back a floodplain, a remnant floodplain. But to the extent that that's active, which I believe it is, you still have to delineate it. So there's a Marley Well drain little bump out to that wetland delineation that you saw. So typically the soils that we have here along the brook, obviously they're alluvial in origin, but then what's immediately next to it is obviously somewhat excessively drained soils. We talked about those. Those are the Merrimacks and the Gloucesters where the septic system wants to be.
George?
Yes, ma'am.
I gave you permission to share a screen if you felt
okay, fine. Sure. I could do that. Pictures are worth a lot, right?
Yeah, you're describing that bump out so well, so I didn't know if.
Okay. What am I doing here?
You're doing good.
Do you see something?
We do. We see your report.
Okay, good. So this is the report. It's dated May 31st this year, obviously to reflect the fact that I was back in May. And this is what I wanted to show you. This, I think, is the picture that makes sense. So roughly, you see the delineation of the lot. It's approximate. It's not exact because all these lines from state GIS are not necessarily correct, and neither are mine. But the idea is that you see the riparian corridor as it comes down and around, and as you can see, the brook is not obviously that wide, and this is where you have some of these poorly drained, very poorly drained alluvial soils. And the little bump up that I was talking is this right here, which you can see is these are 1 foot contours, so it climbs out of the brook 3 feet, possibly up to four, before it so comes back down. And here's the pond, and so my flagging started at A1, and the A23, this little line is what I delineated in May. So I wanted to differentiate. And then what I did, basically I mapped in the field where the rest of the regulated area is, because I didn't actually delineate these green lines, but they're not only they obvious in the field, but they're obvious from the topography that we have. So that is as far as concern. And then I'm just gonna give you a little bit more information from the other report. Oops, well, that's big. Hold on a second. Make it small. All right. So I gave you a quick USGS topo It shows Tunxet State Forest. You see Fox Brook coming in. And it comes way past your municipal boundary. And then, of course, here's the site, and there's the little pond, which apparently was dug out. Well, I apologize for that. I have no way of stopping it. Hold on. Yep, sorry about that. They'll have to call back and leave a message. So here's the municipal boundary, and this little pond, we believe, was, if you look at the 1970 aerial photograph, you don't see a pond, but what you see is a wet area. So I think there might have been already a, because that's where the contours open, as you can see, as the brook comes down. And so someone decided, oh, this is a great place to flood out possibly a marsh and create a pond, which is what happened. A few pictures. Here's a scenic view, I guess, of the brook as it goes downstream towards the pond. Little fern here. This is another view as it, again, a southeasterly, as the brook enters the pond. So you can see it quiets. It's not as much of a riffle. It's, by the way, I did turn over some rocks within the stream. And even though the abundance of macroinvertebrates or benthic organisms was not tremendously high when I saw it, which was a little surprising, yet it had all the kinds of species and genera and taxa that you would expect for a very, very clean, excellent water quality, which is not surprising that the watershed is basically mostly undeveloped. Here's my first flag that I put in May. The pond is kind of in the back there. You can't see it. And then, of course, I turned around and followed, as you can see, along the boundary of the pond. Here's a view of the pond. I didn't do much of an inventory in the pond, but I'm sure there are fish. I did see some black-nosed dace in the stream, and according to Connecticut DEP, a portion of this stream, whether it's upstream or downstream, has both wild brown, wild brook, and black-nosed dace. So trout and dace and probably some other things too. This was interesting to me. This is a part of the property which allows you to get down to the pond, and I started digging in here, and I'm like, oh my goodness, this looks wet, but it ain't. What it is, it's dredge material from the pond, which kind of makes sense. And here's a couple more scenic areas of the brook, which is quite scenic. And I think the last picture is there in the background somewhere, at least 75 feet away from the edge of the brook, will be the structure of the house, which will allow for a nice view. And the footprint of the development relatively is small. I know that it's close to good resource, but it's small. There's not a lot of clearing that's, and you know, we talked with the prospective property owner here and limiting the amount of disturbance, limiting it to a three-bedroom house rather than something that possibly bigger. And it seems to fit very well into the landscape. In the report, I also have a typical inventory that you would have. And then the report basically goes through step by step, giving you my my analysis for the typical impacts that you would look at. So for instance, is there a direct impact? The answer is no. What about erosion sedimentation control? Are there potential risks involved with development of this lot and what's being proposed to the stream, which obviously is exceptional quality? And the answer is no. Number of reasons for that. There's this good erosion sedimentation control strategies and controls that are put in the plan. The area, for the most part, is gentle, except for the garage, which is obviously being developed near the hillside. But there's additional silt fence for that, so there's almost like a double there. The soils are not particularly erodible. They're kind of in the moderate So that's also good. And they do allow for infiltration. So even a large storm would not necessarily run off, but infiltrate into the ground, which is a good thing. The clearing, there's no impacts to hydrology here whatsoever. Obviously, this is a stream that's mostly fed by its watershed. Of course, some groundwater discharge is also happening, but that's not going to be affected by what we're doing here. And then the final category that I always look at is clearing close to resource. When you have a brook, obviously that's more important, because if you open the canopy next to the brook, that obviously can cause a bunch of things, including thermal impacts, algae proliferation, etc. But there's plenty of shading that's happening here, but just the way the topography works, the brook is incised, and then of course it opens into a pond, which is completely an open habitat. So overall, and functions and values, I did give you the typical little table. Sorry, I hope you don't get dizzy to me doing that. And I had a little discussion here. Here's your summary of functions and values. Obviously, a principal function. So a principal function is one that is there and conferred to a moderate high to high level. So obviously, we have a good fishery. Production export, that's more not just the stream and, you know, what's churning around the stream and basically feeding the rest of the stream, and but also what the pond is doing. And also wildlife habitat, very nice. Obviously, it's just tons of undeveloped forested land around. And of course, I always like to, if something's so visually attractive, which this obviously is, that's a principal value. It's something that mankind derives for. So the more people you have there without impacting the rest of the environment, the higher that value. So I guess I enjoyed it. So the wetland scientists put the aesthetic value up because I was there to enjoy it. So again, bottom line for me is that there's no significant and adverse impact that is contemplated from this development from as it's proposed. And that's sort of running through a little bit of my report. And I'll just stop here and answer any questions that you might have.
I'm sorry, I guess I was muted. Can you hear me now?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. George, Fox Brook, where does that drain to? Does it go into another brook?
Goes down to the East Branch of the Salmon River?
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Yeah, which is another exceptional resource in town.
Yeah, it's designated wild and scenic.
And salmon is, I think it's stocked, if I recall, right?
It's what?
I think it's also stocked.
Yes, it is, but it does have some native.
It does, absolutely. Probably some of the same species that they found here. And by the way, the DEP inventory, was it 2006 or 2009? I'm not sure, I don't remember. Right as Fox Brook hits Peck Orchard Road. That's their station.
George, you had, when you had it up on the screen, your report, there was the next line was potential indirect impacts on the resource. Was there anything in that section? I can't get to it on my screen for some reason.
I can get back to it. So again, the categories that I usually have, and you might have seen this from me before, for no direct impacts, but the indirect ones, I typically talk about erosion and sedimentation. That's a short-term impact, potentially. The second one is removal of native vegetation and habitat loss, and that usually has to do with buffers. And obviously, the more sensitive the resources, the more we need to look at that. And what I'm saying there that we are within 23 feet of just one location. Remember, I talked about that little bump out of the moderately well-drained alluvial soils. So there, that little apex, if you will. But as because of the zoning restriction, we have to be 75 feet from the water course. And that, of course, is the case everywhere, which is, for this kind of stream, that's a good 75 feet is a good buffer to protect the resource. And then, of course, I talk about hydrology. In some cases, that is an issue in stream flow, not an issue here. I didn't talk about water quality impacts because this is a relatively small development when in regards to the humongous dilution potential of a very large water course and its watershed. But even so, this is very small development. The roof water will probably infiltrate into the ground within a few feet of the roof spouts, and there's very, very limited amount of other kinds of impervious surface. That's just the driveway and the turnaround in front of the garage. So it's very limited. So that, in my mind, is not something that's, we would have concerns such as if you had a parking lot of some sort for a commercial or industrial facility.
Thank you. Well, before we ask for comments from staff, any other commissioner have any questions for George or Guy?
Just a minor one for Guy. What is the square footage of the house?
You know, I'd have to calculate it, but it's a two-story home. I think the footprint is about 1,200 square feet, including the porch. Adam, am I correct in that? I think you're on mute.
You're on mute, Adam.
Maybe.
No, your microphone is not working.
Right, okay.
You're not on mute. It's still not working.
Write down on a piece of paper and show us. Yeah, the footprint I have in there, it's if you look at the garage is 24 by 24, so that the house is roughly twice the size of that.
1,800 square feet, according to
yeah. So you're looking at, you know, with including the porch, I think you're probably around 1,800 square feet.
And that's what Adam just put in the chat.
Oh, there you go.
Mark, can you hear me now?
There you are.
There you
are. All right, it is a new computer, just like. All right, yeah, we're planning about 1,800 square feet. A porch would make that a little bit larger, but there you go.
Do the drawings show any decks, Adam, in addition to what you've got on the plan? You
talk
about a porch, but I haven't been at too many houses lately where they don't have a big deck.
Yeah, well, we would want some kind of a deck going up to the 75-foot setback area, and 12 feet or so. We haven't really finalized the design of the house. It's just, you know, small family, three bedroom with deck, so you can just, you know, sit out in front of your house. Nothing extreme. We'll probably just keep it pretty simple. That's is to really enjoy the scenery that's there with the trees and the stream. You know, I grew up just nearby and have no desire to turn this into a big yard that you have to mow. It's really just enjoy the nature and scenery that's there and disturb it as little as possible to keep it as much as it is.
I'm just curious, Kate, I'm assuming that if there were modifications outside of the footprint we're approving tonight within the regulated area or even in the upland review, Adam would have to come back or at least do an RFR with you?
Well, first, we can't make any decisions tonight because we have to let the petition period for a public hearing pass or decide to make this public hearing for the next
year.
So with that being said, but to your question, if something did change that changed the footprint, then it would need to come back for a modification of that. If it was a minor modification, you know, just a couple feet in one direction or another, then it's just a quick email and we put in the file or, you know, paper trail. If it's something more dramatic, we'd come back in front of the commission.
Yeah, I understand that, you know, once it's approved, I'm talking about down in the future, because all we can approve eventually is what's in front of us right now.
Correct. So, you know, down in the future, if anything else wants to be done, it would require a permit. If it was something incidental to the enjoyment of a residential property, you know, let's say some of the tree roots got damaged as part of the construction, you know, that would need to come, that could come as an RFR, like you said. Correct.
Okay, before we hear from Kate, any more questions from the commission for the, either the applicant or his expert witnesses? Right, Kate, you want to give us your take on this?
I went out to the site yesterday. It's a beautiful spot. Adam, having a view of that water body from your house, it looks like that's what might happen through the base of those trees there. That'll be a really... that'd be very nice. So in terms of maintaining that open field area, that would be on your property, that what we would think was a wet meadow, but it's dry.
Correct. Where the, up to the border of the pond, where there's a meadow there, that's some of the, when George Logan came out, he said, you know, we looked at that and that's some of the dredge material that they took out of the pond. So we keep that as like open space right there.
Okay.
Yeah, correct.
Okay, and is there anything you'd want to do with that space moving forward?
Probably put a garden there, maybe some chairs. You know, that's it. No gazebos, no structures, nothing like that.
Okay. I'm just looking in terms of areas where you could provide mitigation. If there was something in that area that you could do that would balance some of your impacts in terms of the vegetation, you know, it does nice as it is, as a wet meadow, you know, I think keeping it as something that's only mowed, annually, with, you know, obviously a walking path and maybe a sitting area, but trying to keep that mm-hmm. so it's taller grass. And maybe even the thought of putting a couple of really low growing shrubs, mm-hmm. it may not be a bad idea. We can talk about that a little bit more between now and the next meeting and see if there's anything to ferret out on that, or if there's anything that you would want to do, like, you know, if you wanted to put in some kind of, you know, add some wildflowers into that whole area, that might be a nice backdrop for pollinators and things of that nature. And that might be a way to keep that view at the same time.
That'd be really nice. Yeah, that's a good idea.
Yeah, so we could talk about that. And then when it comes to the house, you know, when I'm looking at this, it looks like in terms of southern exposure for tree clearing, because you have that space between the solar gain, George, if you can confirm this, that the solar gain would not be anything on the brook, at least in that location, and the wetland would be more minimal due to the angle of the sun?
Yeah, so the idea here is this would be a net zero house. We would put solar panels up on the roof at some point, but I'm not looking to take down any trees. You've got enough solar exposure. If you're at the site where the house would be and you look towards the pond, what Kate mm-hmm. is referencing is there's a clearing, and there's a lawn right in front of the pond. And it's clear of large trees, so you'll get some southern exposure from that. And there's no need or desire to do any clear cutting or anything like that to get more solar exposure. So correct. So the sun's coming in from the left, if you will. That's the south. And it's coming across the pond where there are no trees. And there's actually very little large trees between the pond and the house, which gives you a nice view. And that gives you your southern exposure, you know, passive solar heating, and then you put solar panels on top of the roof and you get some solar gain and solar energy from that as well.
Okay, and so that kind of leads right into my next question. I'll stop sharing the screen. You know, in looking at the plan, the tree line is really close to all structures. Especially your garage in the back there. So, you know, I can see there being, these are older trees. They're fairly mature. They have a lot of limbs. So, you know, my concern would be how much is this tree line reality in terms of you existing on this property without worrying about damage to your structures? So,
yeah, there is one tree from the main structure, the main house. There's one tree within, I think it's like 20 feet, 22 feet, that has a rotten heartwood that you can tell. You can see that there's a divot in there, and you can see that that tree would probably have to be removed. And that's a mature tree. It's very large. Otherwise, in 10 years, it could come down in a storm or something like that. Our plan is to, I mean, I've identified two mills already that could, you know, turn these into flooring and furniture material. So we want to use as much of the wood on site that is from a tree like that to use into the construction of the house. With the garage, I'll have to take another look, but there, to the north towards Heartland, there is a large tree, but I think that's far enough away. It's not going to impact it. There might be one or two right by the garage that would have to be removed. There's a couple of other dead standing trees that would be removed by the driveway as you come in. Everything else, though, is relatively new growth. Like there's some small trees that are maybe 4-inch diameter that have that are right by where we did the test pits and whatnot that would be removed. Again, the virtue of the site is really the trees and the topography, and the goal is to remove and disturb as little as possible. Just, you've been there. That's what you would want. You know, you're not there to clear cut and or to create any more views that you don't. You know, just the views of the trees are enough, in our opinion. So, okay. Yeah.
So with the, when I was out there, I saw some flags, some wire flags. I saw some stakes where obviously test pits. Is this, are the four corners of this structure, you know, relative, you know, there's more than four, obviously, but the most extensive corners of the structure, are they marked in the field so the commissioners can see this and myself?
They are not. They're not. We've identified where the 75-foot barrier is, you know, from the wetlands. And from there, it's, that's honestly just my wife and I out there putting flags, trying to figure out what kind of size house might fit and what we might orient it. So, you know, per your approval, we'll finalize, you know, the exact dimensions of what we're looking for and come back to you if need be. So no, that is not, but the 75 feet from the stream is delineated. And then a few of those flags that you see are just brainstorming flags, frankly.
Okay. So if the house was to be twisted, you know, I'm looking at this in terms of trying to get it away from that wetland flag A16. And I'll share my screen again so everybody can see what I'm talking about. It's just the closest point of contact to the resource areas. Are you guys able to see it again?
Yeah.
So, you know, right here, you're on the edge of the 75 feet with the porch. And then, you know, you're fairly close. I don't know if maybe Guy has a measurement on this. I don't have the paper plan in front.
I thought that was 23 feet.
23, okay. Yeah. So, you know, 23 feet is pretty close in terms of how we tend to do things on a fresh lot. You know, we're looking for usually at least 50 feet of a separation from the wetland boundary. So while we're having that 75 feet from the stream, what we'd really like to do is try to get closer to that 50-foot boundary. I'm not sure if that's possible on this property. You know, when I'm looking at this now, you know, you are able to build in quite a bit into the hillside for the garage. And I like the fact that the garage is going on the opposite side of that access way in your driveway, keeping things from getting built up over closer to the brook. Like if you were to have an attached garage, that would definitely create more impact over in this area. But, you know, if this house was to swing, you know, as far as it could and still accommodate these detanks, that would then pull it away, you know, while you still have the 75 feet, it pulls it away from that wetland area. And when I was out there, this contour here, which I don't see any numbers on it, but so where the contours kind of level out, pretty much right where the edge of the clearing is, mm-hmm. It'd be nice to have it up on, because that's like a little hill, a tiny little hill,
yeah.
Just down and it goes down. You know, the more that we could keep it back from that little perch, You know, because that kind of creates, like, you know, I'm looking at that, and George, you can comment on this. I know that there is no mapped flood elevations for this, but when I look at that kind of outwash area, to me, that looks like if there was going to be a floodplain, it would be in that lower portion that's adjacent to the stream that's approximately at the same elevation. So, you know, we're talking about this area here, right through here. So I think that would be the biggest thing, is just to see how far, if possible, you could have this come away from the wetland boundary as well as the water course, you know, and keeping it within that 75 feet so you don't have to work with planning and zoning, and maybe having it where your driveway, you know, comes in more. I don't know.
I think we can move it to the north a bit there from where I see.
Yeah, just take a peek, because that's pretty tight. So you guys, I mean, you'll have time between now and the next meeting to think about that, and you can stand out there and put more flags in the ground with your wife, and you know, make sure no horse flies get you. And you know, I think there could be some maneuvering unless there's something holding it to that location. So that would be my biggest comment, was, you know, how much farther can you get that from the well? And you know, the second one is just making sure, I think we would have to have a condition of approval that we go in there and mark the tree, or at least maybe have that limit of clearing marked to some extent to understand, because while the intention is never to put, you know, have, you know, worry about a tree coming down, I think in this past year, what, we had 3 issues with people having trees fall on their house, and those are the people that related to wetlands. This wasn't just the rest of the town. So, you know, I get a little concerned that maybe you sell it, Adam, God forbid you sell it, and, you know, somebody else comes in and they're like, oh my God, these trees are all going to, you know, fall on my daughter's bedroom. You know, that's exactly what was happening in town, and it's just not safe. So I think maintaining that tree line, especially as we get closer to the wetland boundary, is essential. And so making sure, you know, if you have any questions about those trees as part of your construction, you're, you know, taking limbs off and balancing. And maybe George can speak to that a little bit. But that's pretty much all I have for comments at this point. I can correspond between now and the next meeting if there's anything else that comes up. And I think the commission, unless you have any other responses or questions, making a determination as to whether or not you feel this deserves or requires a public hearing because of being a significant activity or significant impacts or public interest. And so they can decide how they come back to our next meeting.
Kate, I just, you did bring up the subject, and actually George touched upon it. When you're dealing with a water course like this, particularly a pristine one, the buffers are super, super important. And, you know, we've had this issue before, and it was completely innocent, where people were worried about the safety of their families and took trees out. So in the past, you know, as we're thinking about what conditions might apply, you know, delineation of the buffers, you know, we've made that a condition before, so that subsequent, my impression is Adam appreciates the trees just as I do looking through the trees from my deck, but the next owner may not. And, you know, if they don't understand that there's a delineated wetland there and there's a buffer that has to be there to protect that stream, mistakes can happen, you know, and we've seen it happen. Kate's right, 3 times this year, and intentions were good. No one did anything with a sinister motive, but it's just a lack of understanding of wetlands regulations and how important buffers are for water courses, particularly little streams like this, where, you know, the temperature, you can raise the temperature in that stream by just taking a handful of trees out, and that would be a negative impact. I'm just offering that for, you know, so we can just start thinking about how we would condition this approval if that's what the commission wants to do.
And if I may, I apologize. There's one other question I did have, minor. What's the driveway material going to be? Is it all going to be gravel?
Yeah, I'm not looking to pay some gravel of some sort.
So unless anyone has anything else, I think the next question is the commission inclined to set it for a public hearing, or just rather to wait for the you know, request for a public hearing period to run and see whether anyone from the public asks for a public hearing? What are the commission's thoughts on that?
I just wait to see if we hear anything. I don't think, personally, I don't think there's a need for a public hearing.
Orel, you're kind of nodding your head. Yeah.
Nick.
There's Nick. Oh, there's Nick. Nick, we can't hear you or see you. So what are your thoughts?
Yeah, sorry, I'm on a computer without a camera. I mean, it seems pretty responsible to me. No major red flags. I do have a concern long term. You're just saying, properties are forever. So once there's a change of hands, you could always have somebody that could decide they want to do something different with the lines of sight and everything. But I don't know. Long term, what can you do about that?
Okay, so I read you to say that you're with the rest of the commission. I certainly feel this way, that we don't need to set it for a public hearing unless someone from the public asks for it.
Yeah, I think that's appropriate.
Okay. All right, then, Kate, I don't think we have to do anything but move it to the next agenda in what month are we in? June? July. Hopefully we have a quorum and it's summertime, you know.
Sure, you'll all show up.
Okay, anything else? All right, thank you all for a great presentation. Good luck. We'll see you next month, hopefully.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Appreciate it.
All right, have a good evening.
All right, now we turn to things that have been scheduled for public hearings. So we have two public hearings on the same piece of property that we're all pretty familiar with at this point. So 123 R K Street. They're related, and this gets all confused with this particular application. So do we want to address them separately, Kate? What are you comfortable with, A and B? First is the application seeking an amendment to the wetlands map, which was continued from May 11th, and the second is a permit application to construct a single family home and associated improvements within a regulated area. That was also continued for May 11th.
My recommendation would be to go forward with the wetlands map amendment and discuss the enforcement activities along with the permit activities all together, and also get an update on what's been done in terms of the enforcement work that can be done. So okay. Have the wetlands map go first. I think we can close that out, actually, if the commission feels comfortable, and then we can go to the permit with the enforcement order together.
Okay, so who wants to present on behalf of Mr. Foley on that first part of the public hearing?
Brian Deno here from Deno Land Surveying. We prepared the plans and we've made the revisions for the wetlands map amendment that were requested from the previous meeting. In the previous meeting, we were asked to include a water course on our 100 scale plan that shows the wetlands amendment, and also the 100-foot setback from the wetlands and the 200-foot setback from the water course. And if you look at sheets 1 and 2 of your plans, those have been added.
So can someone just punch that up there?
And I think you have a share screen option there. Let me know if you don't.
There you go, right here. This is the sheet 1 of the plans.
Yeah.
Which shows the area that Kate was concerned with, showing the water course here. When we went on our walk, it actually showed that. And then we show the 200-foot setback and the 100-foot setback from, here's the 200-foot setback from a water course. And then here's the 100-foot setback from wetlands. And on sheet 1 and 2, we show that on the whole site. Here's the 100-foot setback from the wetlands. Here's the 200-foot setback from water course. And if we go to colored plans, it will show better the color plans are in a different one. There you go. This shows, like, the color plans, I did not add the setbacks because I just wanted you to be able to see the flagged wetlands and what the town wetlands were. The town wetlands, the official wetlands, were shown in red, the actual field located wetlands are blue, the ones that George did. I can't get to my other one because it's behind something here. There's sheep one. And that shows the town wetlands in red, following pretty much the flag wetlands in this area, and a small town wetlands up here, and then our field flag wetlands there in the front and down there. And if you go back to my original plan, that shows all the setbacks that she asked for. The water course here, the water course is in here, and the water course is coming down the hill.
And everybody else hearing that, excuse me, but is everybody else hearing that buzzing?
No.
It's no. Just me then. Okay.
Oh, there it is.
I am.
No. When you speak, we hear it.
Oh, so does that mean it's me?
What did you just get?
It's good now.
What did you just get? Is this a new computer, Fred?
Yeah. Apparently.
Hey, next month we'll go all, maybe we'll all be in person.
There you go.
Good.
Good. Fred says good, yeah. You'll have to come back from your vacation home, Fred.
Yeah.
So my question, Kate, is, you know, obviously this is an application to amend the wetlands map. Did they get everything that you wanted to see?
Correct. And what I have, Brian, if you want to stop the share. Thank you. I'm going to share my screen. So what I have here is a draft wetlands map amendment approval for you guys. It's the basics, but we wouldn't be referencing the colored plans, for the colored plans don't show the streams on there, and we don't have the details that we need. But on here, we're referencing the whole plan set, because you can see the details when you flip through the plan set with the numbers a lot better. So it's all right there. So everything that I needed was captured with this. So I feel that we could close this out and issue this if the commission felt the same.
I just have a question, and excuse my, I was going to say ignorance, but I'll say naivete. So George and Brian, they determined the actual on-the-ground delineations of the wetlands, and they mapped those. That was the color map. So how does that amend the existing wetlands map? Is it just added to it, or do the old lines now become the new lines?
The old lines become the new lines.
Okay.
Now, on GIS, we have not had the funding available and the staff to get that to reflect onto our GIS, but what we have is the files, so we are able to pull it up, and that would stand.
So we'll be able to do that, but the GIS, anyone who goes to that GIS map will be seeing the old map, but the official Town of Granby wetlands map will be as delineated on the color map that Brian showed us tonight.
The color map was just so you could see the official wetlands map.
Yeah.
And the actual field located one, the sheets 1 and 2 with all the flag okay. numbers on it will be the one all I put right. on file.
Yep.
And when I file plans with the town, I usually get a call from Larry Fisher. He directs your GIS, and I send him an AutoCAD file.
Oh, nice.
And when he's asked to update the files, he includes the maps I send him.
Okay. Does anyone else have any questions regarding the first part of the public hearing, the application seeking an amendment to the wetlands map? Burrell shook her head no. She's the only commissioner whose head I can see. So I'm going to assume, without hearing anything else, we can entertain a motion to approve. Correct, Kate?
Mm-hmm, correct.
All right.
Okay, I move that we approve. What are we approving? Oh, the wetlands.
The amendment to the wetlands map.
Right.
Thank you, Aurel.
I'll second that.
Fred seconds. Okay. Any further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
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 That's all four of us. So I won't ask for any opposition or abstentions. It's unanimous. Thank you. All right. We'll go to this. You ready for the second phase, Kate? Professionals?
Yep.
Applicant? Sure. Let's go to the second. So the second part of the public hearing is a permit application to construct single-family home and associated improvements within a regulated area. Okay, who's going to present on that?
That'd be me, Brian, from Dental Land Surveying. This is a continuation of the last few hearings, and we've been asked to make revisions and corrections to our plan by both Kate and the town engineer, Kevin Clark. We have made those revisions and turned them into the town, and if Kate wants to speak first on what she asked for, or if she wants me to go over her letter and Kevin's letter, let me know.
Yeah, Brian, because we got the plans yesterday and I got George's letter today at 3:15, I think it was, I haven't had time to dissect and look at all these details. So if you could maybe pull the plans up and just show in each area, and George can speak to each of the bullet items. So for the commission, as you have in your packet there, there's a May 26th letter. It's a review letter. And there's also a May 16th letter from Kevin, our town engineer. So those are the two letters that Brian and his team, George, are addressing for the application.
All right, here I'm going to bring up the plans.
I'm looking at a letter from George, June 8th, 2022. That's what you were talking about, Kate?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep, that's George. He'll go over his letter after we go over Kevin Clark's letter from May 13th, 2022. It's one sheet. He starts off with his review of sheets 3, 4, and 5.
Yep.
Number one was correct the map scale, which we've done. Number two, these aren't really things that, I mean, I can blow them up on the scale on the plan if you want, but they're really self-explanatory for the most part. He asked, is the farm road existing or new? Farm road, he's talking about, is this farm road here? So I wrote on it, existing farm road. He asked that I had to match numbers, say, because I have grading plans 1, 2, and 3, and I said C sheet 1, C sheet 2, but he wanted me to make them so they were the sheet numbers of the plan. So that's what I did. You know, this is actually sheet 3, and that's sheet 4, and that's sheet 5. So I changed my match numbers to match the bottom right-hand corner instead of the sedimentation erosion control plan. So I did that, which he asked for. Existing contours too light. So as you can see, the numbers on the contours, existing contours are here. I've made darker so you can see them better for his request. Existing proposed vegetation to remain are the same. Sometimes that is hard for people to see, but if you look at my plan, I change them because they're usually, one is much darker than the other, but sometimes PDFs, you don't see them that good. So I change the type of this, like this is going to remain and this is going to be all cut. And actually there should be a note there that because of the PDF, maybe it didn't come over, but so I changed that for him as he requested. Show water courses and wetland symbols in the legend. And there they are in the legend at the bottom there. And what are additional sediment logs? The sediment logs are shown, and if you look at the key for this is pretty much taken right from the sedimentation erosion control manual 2004. We have existing sediment logs and proposed sediment logs, and those are labeled on the plan. And then he asked number 9 for sheets 3, 4, and 5, is the farm building existing or proposed? That would be let's wait for the computer to catch up. There it is. The proposed farm building up here, right in the beginning, along the new road. So that was his comments for the farm building. Then he asked for fix the cross section for the septic design. I do not have septic approval yet from Farmington Valley, but we did change the cross section here. All it does, it shows the depth and elevation of the septic system. for the review of Farmington Valley to be able to approve it and say how far into the ground the system is. We change that.
Hey Brian, I don't remember you. You might have answered addressed number two. Is reclaim process drive existing? Is this need to be graded or new?
Oh, sorry. Yep, that's. We can zoom right in here. What we have is we have the farm road that he's been constructing, and then. It's going to be covered. It's going to use reclaim. See, it's an existing farm road, and we're going to propose reclaim over the whole thing.
Okay.
That way we'll prevent the gravel and fines from running off the road and into any wetlands or into the woods. So the applicant has said he's going to put reclaim down everywhere.
Thank you.
And that's proposed. Yep, I did miss that one, sorry. And then his next comment was for sheet 8. Which is the sedimentation erosion control details. This sheet. He asked that we say that the stumps are to be removed. That was on there, but then he asked for a couple more notes and we added those. Registration with the DEP is required for all sites over disturbance of over than 5 acres. That was there, but he asked us to quantify the amount of clearing. In a pre-construction meeting, he asked for that. And then over to the right, we have a soils erosion and sedimentation control narrative. And he asked for additional numbers to quantify what was happening. He wanted to know the total area of disturbance, what the site consisted of, how many wetlands are on the site. That's actually right in the application. Total regulated area on the site, 35 acres. Total wetlands to be disturbed are 442 square feet. That's down by the pond crossing, where we're adding a one length of pipe. Then the total area of disturbance would be all the tree cutting, all the construction, and that is 13.9 acres. And then his last number 13 was at a pre-construction meeting with right here. And that would cover Kevin's comments, or at least the comments I've received from him for now.
Do you mind if I just back up real quick on one of those?
Go right ahead.
So where he was looking for the existing, existing stone swell to be regraded. Which detail will be used for construction? So on the detail sheet, I didn't see which one.
Well, where's that
graph and the, let me look. My
clients. Yeah, one of his notes or one of yours?
His notes.
Oh, that would be, that's, gotta go up.
So, When I was speaking with him, you have a stone swale and you have a grass swale detail, and then knowing where each one of those will go, is that specified?
That's part of yours, but Kevin was asking for sediment logs.
So and, the existing stone swale to be regraded, which detail will be used for construction? So he was referencing the two details for the swales.
I don't see that comment on his sheet.
So I'm looking at comment number 10.
Which is fixed section AA.
So comment number 10 under sheets 3, 4, and 5.
I don't have a comment number 10. They go to 9. The last one under sheets 3, 4, and 5 is farm building.
This one's May 13th, not May 16th.
Mine's May 13th, yeah.
How did that happen? Okay.
I mean, if you send me that, I'll address it.
My apologies. The May 16th is the one that I'm not sure.
I've not seen that one.
That was I think that's my fault on that. So, he was looking for to know.
That was one of your comments also.
Yeah. Yeah, so.
And I did label that where we're putting the grass swale.
Okay, good.
On the existing farm road.
Good.
I mean, I still have the stone swale detail on there, but I do not have a stone swale detail on my plans right now.
So on sheet 12 of 12, where it says stone swale detail?
Right, I don't have the stone swale detail at this time. Instead, we're putting in a rock wall.
So the detail's not on the plans, even though I have the plans you just submitted yesterday?
Well, no, I mean, the detail is there, but I don't have him constructing one.
Gotcha, okay. So
yeah.
So that would be appropriate.
I can exit out.
Yeah, okay. Because it's just confusing because you don't know which one's going where. So let me just go over really quickly the last couple comments, and I really apologize that date got screwed up there. So the rest of that is, will there be enough room between the drive and the wetlands to regrade the swale as detailed? And Brian, I think you and I talked about that. You took care of that as related to the wetlands.
Correct. We actually removed that drive over 5 feet, and we're going to hold the grade that's there. And not go any closer to the wetlands and put in an under drain in the swale that's there right now, backfill it with stone, and then because we're right here, we're moving the road over towards the west, north, northwest, southwest, 5 feet, and use that area that's already disturbed to put in a small retaining wall. I think it'll be about 2 to 3 feet tall, and behind it we'll put Marafi paper and fill it with stone and put a drain underneath it. And that way we won't go any closer to this flagged wetlands that George flagged.
Okay.
And George has a small discussion about that wetlands.
Okay. Just keep going through this list from Kevin. Number 11 was show proposed inverts and any associated grading and stabilization for the new 12-inch HDPE under the farm road, which I think that was my comment as well.
Yeah, I got that on your comment, and we added grades on it. And there was one question about, you know, do we have to clear any more trees here? This is the drip line. It's not the actual, there's not a trunk, a tree trunk there. It's the trees are bigger here, so the drip lines go out sometimes 15, 20 feet from where the trunk is. And when we walk this area, if you remember, it's actually pretty open woods. So he can construct this without doing any other clearing in the area. And if you zoom in there, you can see that we have some existing grades and a proposed grade to put cover over the pipe.
Okay.
You know, there's proposed grade. Yeah, it's on there.
Perfect.
We can adjust that.
And then the other one was providing a large detail of extension of the 36-inch RCP, show details of the work within the wetlands watercourse, including grading and slope stabilization.
That comment I did not see, so I did not address it.
Okay. And just for the commission, you know, just to put it out there, the timeline in which we receive these responses, you know, I haven't been able to put together anything final or go through this in detail at this point. So, you know, in terms of my comfort level with checking on the plans, I feel like I would need more time since it was submitted so recently. So I think, you know, those details might be reasonable to still address. And again, my deep apologies, Brian. I thought you had the more recent one. So we can talk about that later. So if you want to, Brian, if you want to keep going on the other comments that were part of my letter.
Brian, can I just interrupt? It's my naivete. On just looking at the May 13th, 2022 letter 12E, total area to be disturbed, which you said was 13.9 acres. Just so I can put this in perspective, that 13.9 it says to be disturbed, but you're also including what's already been disturbed, what we looked at the site visit. Do I have that right?
Yeah, a lot of it includes that backfield.
Okay.
The fields that are completely outside of the wetlands jurisdiction, out of the out of the upland review, but it is a number that engineers like to see, because if it's over 5 acres, we have to register with the state. If it's over 10 acres, we have to prepare a plan. And that, so that's what he's looking for. That's the numbers he's looking for.
Yeah, I just want, it's just for my own reality check, because it sounds as if it was to be disturbed. It's at the end of the project, that's what will
happen. Right, yeah. The DEP doesn't care if you disturb it now or 5 years from now or 10 years from now. If it's on the same site, it all counts.
Gotcha. Thank you. So I think Kate, again, I think you still have the floor, Brian, addressed.
Okay. All right, so moving on to Kate's letter. Her first letter is, her first page of her letter is really a description of the plans and the project. And then page two.
Everybody, I just replaced the letter on OneDrive with the May 16th letter from Kevin, and I also emailed that over to Brian and the team.
All right, Kate, I cannot find your page two. Read them to me, I will go to them on the phone.
So we're going over the enforcement order items. Some of them overlap with the.
I'm sorry, I do have it. It said enforcement order on the top, but I thought that was something different. Number one is the plan review by the town engineer, which we've just gone over. Number two is the reclaim process drive. It's shown as approximately 30 feet from the wetlands 7A in this area right here. And in that area, after our site walk and discussions with Kate, we have moved the drive over 5 feet, which will cut into the field a little bit, but it will also allow us to do an under drain here, to catch the water coming off of here, and put in a small stone retaining wall to hold back and stop any more erosion from happening. George can speak more about that small wetlands a little later. And then number three, show inverts and elevations. We just went over that from Kevin's letter. That's the pipe over here that we just discussed. Number four, the restoration of the steel plate, which George addresses in his letter. The steel plate is the one down by the pond. How I ended up with a blank sheet in the middle. The steel plate is right here, which they put down over the brook to get into the area where the borrow pit was, which is going to be regraded and seeded, which we discussed before.
Did you take the note off about seeing George's report on that?
No, I don't think I did, because now you asked me to reference the report and the date, which I didn't get till today, so.
Yeah.
It is in George's report now.
Okay.
Then the next one was the site plan shows stone and grass swale details. Please define on the plans where the stone versus grass swales will be constructed. Originally, this was going to be a stone swale where the retaining wall is now in this area. And the plans have been revised to show a grass lined swale over here on the farm road in this area here, where it's kind of rough right now, but it is functioning correctly, but we want to, you know, put grass to stabilize it permanently. Number six is a detailed listing letter, which George has provided, which we will go over in a little bit. And that is mostly everything for the enforcement order. And then we also have a permit application. And again, it's see the plan review by the town engineer, which we have gone over. This one, Kate, please clarify proposed grading contours where necessary as it relates to their confluence with the existing contour. Here's our proposed contour, and it ends when it hits the existing contour. like that. I mean, that's, and our proposed contours are all solid, and then the existing contours are dashed.
Yeah, it looked like with the house and also with that borrow pit, there were just right angles in terms of the contours out there.
Yes, I mean, theoretically, you know, at this scale, that's what you're going to get. In reality, at the end, they'll be round a little bit. You know, here's the contours.
Yeah, those are
where the house is being built.
Yeah, if you go south to the loop.
Yep.
Yeah. And then the ones that were in the pit were very abrupt.
Yes, because they're steeper.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you want me to, I can fillet them and make them smooth if you'd like.
If you can just show that area so the commission can see it. So they understand what we're talking about.
Hold on. We don't want to be on a 20 scale. This area right here.
Yeah, so when you look at that really steep section, you know, it seems like in terms of that 990, you know, you'd really have to pull that.
I mean, I can put an arc, a small radius there if you'd like.
I'm looking at that side over there. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what exists. I mean, this is actually a handheld topo. After he cleared it, we located the edge of clearing.
So, Brian, you're going to have a right angle with your contours on dirt?
No, that's what I'm saying. I can smooth that off again, but that's, you know, I can do that.
Yeah, that way we just have the full area and what the contours mm-hmm. will be, so he'll have that to work with. So, I mean, I'd imagine that's going to feather quite a bit down away from where it is now.
Not a problem.
Thanks.
The tree line associated with the structure, that's the one we discussed about how the trees are larger up there, and he should not have to clear any more trees to put that pipe in. I believe this is the one you're talking about, because I show the...
Well, actually, I was talking about around the structure.
Which structure?
The house, the proposed house. Like, you seem like you have different line types now, when it's hard to see.
Correct. Yes, Kevin has those different line types.
Yep. So you darkened it because before you couldn't even tell.
Right there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so.
These trees are all going to be removed. These are going to remain.
Yep. Okay.
The proposed mitigation area. Up top, I think you're talking about the area of how much we're actually going to gain there.
Mm-hmm.
And I added a note there, and George also added it to his letter that we will do an as-built there when we are done. Added a note. Where's my note? I do not see my note on my plan. I know I added it.
You have a note that says total note.
I added a note that will be as built and will actually add the actual area of mitigation that was in wetlands that was created. And George is going to discuss that also.
Okay. And are you presenting that square footage still in terms of wetland area?
Our direct wetlands impact is 450 feet plus or minus. And the area that is shown shaded is 12,300. And when it is built and when it is done, George will go over this in his letter, that he is going to go out and reflag and show exactly what was created as wetlands. And we will do an as-built of it and add that to our plan so it can be put on file. I mean, the big concern you have here is later on, you know, they want to use that as a bank if they expand somewhere else. So,
yeah,
you know, we need to know that number exact. And I agree with you, and that's the way we'll do it.
Yeah, and just to mention, I think that sounds fine. Because you have so much excess square footage in replication area, I'm not highly concerned. But ideally, you know, especially if it was closer, I would not want to be counting in areas that we're not going to have grade changes. Yeah, I think those should be totally out of the discussion and not shown as being a shaded area for wetland creation. But, you know, in terms of how we're working this, because it's so much more, I think that's acceptable way to go about it. I think anytime you come in front of us next time, I would really want to make sure if you're not lowering elevations, that we're not calling that a wetland creation area.
Yeah, there is the note. So I put it on the 20 scale.
Yeah. Because it's just deceiving to whoever's, you know, trying to work with it. That's all.
All right. At this time, I believe George would like to go over his letter, and he has some other information to give you.
If you could stop sharing your screen, and I'll share mine. Okay. Oh, boy. Where to go? Hold on a second. Something disappeared. I guess I have to make it come up in the screen before I can share it.
I think this whole meeting is prompting us to go to in-person meetings next month.
I hear you. I'm all for it.
we're all struggling to some extent.
Jeez. All right. You think after months and years of doing this, I figure it out. Anyhow, so just one admission here before I start. I've been so extremely busy that's why I did this so late this afternoon. I had actually three reports going out today. So Kate, I apologize if I didn't exactly hit the mark in responding. This might have been more of a global thing. I think these are the things we need to discuss, but there might be some nuances and little things in there that we might have to address as we go forward. But anyhow, so what I try to do is, and Brian helped me, he took a map and scribbled and said 1, 2, 3, 4, and then sent it to me. So I basically said 1, 2, 3, 4. The first one we've already kind of discussed, and that was the wetland creation area. It's not a mitigation area, it's a replication or creation area. As you recall, even though we're saying in the plan that there's 12,300 and something square foot of a potential of wetland creation, my notes that are somewhere embedded in one of the plans that Brian put together said that the goal was 10,000 square feet. And the reason for that is because I wanted to be double of what we originally were impacting. Remember, we were close to 5,000 square feet. So let's call it a 2-to-1. What's going to end up happening there? The goal is 10,000. Whatever's going to happen, again, the contours that you see would show that we're removing at least a foot of subsoil, basically, and a couple of sumps. That might morph in the field a little bit, and so we might actually get a little more than that. I don't think that would be an issue. So that will make sure that we hit the 10,000. So that was that. And of course, the as-built survey. So to clarify, when you're looking to figure out what's actually been created, since this is new, the soils don't necessarily tell us everything. So you have to almost go, and Kay will understand that, with a three-parameter approach of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. And look at hydrology. You're going to look at soils, but you know there are only so many characteristics you're going to be looking and seeing in the soils because they're going to be young. You know, some redox problem at the bottom of the A, something like that. Oxidized rhizospheres, yes. But then you're looking at hydrology. You're looking at the wetland vegetation to see how do you have a facultative wet obligate community here. Then I call that a wetland, and that could also be a wetland under. Statutory under the water course definition of the Connecticut statute, which says not the water course in a defined channel, but a water course based on a obvious vegetative wetland community. So if you have a marsh, well, even if the soils have been caught up, it's regulated. Anyhow, I don't want to go into the weeds. The second thing was the restoration and enhancement along the proposed driveway. And the concern there was the wetland 7A. And I wanted to show you something. I want to show you a picture. So here's when I delineated it back in 2019. Of course, I delineated it before in 2006. That is the furthest out flag. I forget which one that might probably 7A2. So this a pre-existing pathway was going right through the wetland. And this wetland was probably more or less created by taking some material out of here, right up against the property boundary, and creating this this pathway. And you can see that it's flanked by multi-floor rows. So what we're doing now is we're basically restoring all this and then going off another X amount of feet beyond that to the left or down gradient, which is all good. But what I did say here is that my druthers would be, and if Kate agrees and the commission agrees, that what I would want to do is once all the particular improvements that Brian talked about associated with sort of the realignment, pushing this thing 5 feet over, doing the retaining wall, the swale with ender drain, et cetera. If once that's in, for me to then to take a look and say, okay, based on what I'm looking at now, this is what I would be proposing to protect this wetland 7A and create a buffer there that's appropriate for the functions and values of this wetland. So, and you know, then I said we could be doing some clonal species, which include gray dogwood, and bayberry, and sweet pepper bush. Although sweet pepper bush doesn't particularly like the higher elevation, so we'll have to think about that. Northern arrowwood, nannyberry, that kind of thing. So I'm kind of leaving it a little open for me to be able to come in once the improvements have been made and then tailor a specific plan for that, if that's okay. The next one was the restoration of the wetland at the temporary crossing. And for that, I wanted to show you this picture, which I also took back in 2019. And it shows you where the crossing is, which was right here. And as you can see, there was not a lot of vegetation that was taken down. Some was taken down, probably at the edge or right outside of the wetland itself. So the idea here, now you have some logs, you have a steel plate, you have some soil disturbance, obviously it's happened. And of course you have some sediment that has kind of reconfigured itself around this whole thing as, you know, as the stream has been, you know, for the bigger storms, has been kind of constricted. So once the logs are removed, once the steel plates removed, again, the idea would be to reconstitute something similar to what you see here. Make sure you have a good vegetative media. And then what I proposed is to use this shotgun approach, which we've used before, and this is New England erosion control restoration mix for moist areas, which combines facultative species, the kind of wet stuff, and then some facultative species, and even a couple that are on the upper portion of the spectrum, if you will. And that's something that would stabilize the area and cover it with some straw, not obviously right next to the channel, and let nature take its course for that. So that would be my plan. Then we have the number four area, which is a little more intensive. This is the area where we went into the wetland for about 440, I think, square feet of wetland disturbance. So fill in the wetland, disturbance in the wetland, disturbance in the upland review area or the buffer. So there I was a little more specific as to what I would be proposing. And so I'm not going to go into it in great detail, but you can see I've enumerated all these things and included, again, using that seed mix that I talked about, but then how are we going to get the fill out? How far are we going to come up? What are we doing for temporary erosion and sedimentation, and maybe even a little more long term? And what are we planting in there? And so I got 20, I think if I counted them right, and have four trees and one larger shrub, and again, another 15 shrubs to be planted in there, specified what their heights would be, as large as we can get them for from New England Wetland Plants Inc., which is the go-to place for native, good native stuff. And that would be it. And all that will be done under the supervision of someone like myself. So if I keel out or decide to go to Europe and retire, it's someone else going to be doing this who hopefully has the same credentials as I do. So that's kind of quickly running through what hitting those four areas. And again, I have a conclusion, and the conclusion is that, you know, with all this restoration, enhancement, and wetland creation and replication, we're going to have a modest enhancement of wetland functions and values on the property when you're just looking at, you know, the wetland area numbers, if you will, and what we're doing in each one of those areas. So, yeah, and I understand there's a little bit of mitigation banking that's in this, and we'll see how that goes down the line when and if we have to come back to this commission with any other proposals for the property. That's all I got for now.
Any questions for from the commission for either George or Brian, or the applicant for that matter?
The applicant has been doing some erosion controls per the enforcement order, and he would like to update Kate and the commission on what he's been doing.
Sure. Brendan?
Oh, yeah. Hi, everybody. Thank you for your time. And thank you, Brian and George, for your guys' hard work on getting all this done. Yeah, so I've been out there doing quite a bit of work. And I've got some photos. I don't know if you want me to bring them up, I can.
Let me give you permission to share.
Okay. But most of the work has been pertaining to excavating the sediment that did run off into the wetlands, you know, last season. So that has since all been excavated in both of those areas. I went in. Here's the area that that pipe goes into. So, and it's actually growing. It's growing in pretty densely already back in there.
Brendan, you're not sharing yet.
Yeah, oh, we can't see it, Brendan.
Oh, okay. How do I? Do I have to do something on my end here to share?
Yeah, a little green button in the bottom.
Oh yeah, share screen. Now, can you see me?
We can see you now. Do share. You gotta select what screen or what you want to share. Your next. There you go.
Okay.
Nice.
All right. So. Oh yeah, that's yeah, here's that like wetland that got some sediment in it under where that pipe drained out on the farm road that we're gonna propose to be the driveway. So I excavated all that out, and it looks like it's really grown back in pretty thick. That was that one. Let's see, here's the other area on the east side of the crossing that we had been proposing earlier, excavated all that out. So I got that done. And then basically, you know, I've just been working on improving like the check dams. Let's see, the check dams and the TSTs, like I made these quite a bit more robust, and have just been excavating sediment anytime there has been, but it's been really minimal. Like that big storm we had, I think about a week or two ago, that rained pretty substantially overnight. There was really no sediment, very little sediment collecting in all the traps that I've built. So that was nice. Yeah, and then also just install all those swales are installed. They've all been maintained and are working well. I think you guys might have seen this, but I filled in the area to the west of the crossing where we messed up that 440 square feet. I filled that all in with wood chips. I haven't, you know, worked on pulling that stuff back yet, just because I didn't quite know what I needed to do once I pulled it out of there in terms of replanting and stuff like that. But it seems like I've got enough information to go ahead and do that work, which should be pretty quick to pull that stuff out of there with the excavator. And then similarly up on the farm road, I haven't done a ton of work up there yet further in terms of laying down any other materials. I was kind of waiting for the grade on that pipe before putting that in. But I do have some sediment mats that I'm ready to do the loaming and the soil and seeding of that eastern side of the road going down into the wetlands there. So I'll get that done shortly.
Dried up enough so you can do that work, Brendan?
What's that?
Has it dried up enough so you can do that work?
Yeah, until tomorrow probably. But hopefully, it's really stable there though. I mean, I've got that culvert on the side is really well built. There's the big TST that's working well. But yeah, I think just you know a day or two of dry weather and I can get back in there and get that done. And I do feel like I've got good direction to really start hammering away on those things from Brian and George now, especially on that farm road. And then, you know, it'll take me a little while to gear up a crew to bang out the entire road and laying down all the process and stuff. But I plan to hammer that away as soon as possible. But I'll be up there all day tomorrow again, kind of making sure everything's functioning and we're not getting run off. So the site is feel very stable. Like that pit area has actually all grown in with grass. I know we still have to do all the grading and everything there, but it seems to be stable at the time being. That's kind of what I've been working on. Planted 250 Christmas trees up in the front, one of the front fields there. That's about all I've got.
And I also spoke with the contractor, and to my knowledge, he's going to start going up there with you.
Oh, good.
So that, you know, and that's something that the town staff asked for is, you know, who's the responsible person that's going to oversee your work that's in the business. So I did speak with Jeremy, and he knows that you're getting ready to do it, and he says he's going to be up.
Awesome. Yeah. I kind of gave him the heads up that we got the meeting tonight and start gearing up pretty soon. So, it just takes a couple days to get the equipment up there and get the materials company lined up and get our game plan. But we should be able to get it done for sure.
Brendan, if you don't mind, just stop sharing unless you have other pictures to show or anything else to show. Grammy TV likes to see all of our faces.
Sure. I'd rather see the backdrop there, the mountains.
I know, it's actually like a stock Apple photo. And then I guess otherwise, you know, I don't know if now's the right time to kind of say this, but, you know, just with the permit application and everything and what we're, Emily and I are really hoping to accomplish out there is, you know, we feel pretty small, little farm estate and Christmas tree farm. And We hope it goes through. We're looking really forward to it, and just really appreciate everybody's consideration. That's all I've got.
Anyone on the commission have any questions? This is still a public hearing, but I don't see any public, you know, on the screen. But I'll ask the question: is there anyone from the public who wants to ask a question of the applicant or any of his professionals? Don't hear anything. All right. So, Kate, you indicated, I believe, that you wanted to address some of the issues that were presented, or some of the points that were presented to you today. So, I don't even know, you know, where we are in terms of the public hearing. Can we leave it open while you do that, or do you?
Yeah, so the public hearing only started at our last meeting.
Okay, that's
That's the one I wasn't at. Okay, so that's when we started the public hearing.
We just have been hanging out for a really long time.
Yeah, it seems like that. Yeah,
it does.
But we did enjoy our site visit, Brendan. I must say the property is absolutely gorgeous.
Awesome.
It made my weekend. I talked about it all weekend.
Awesome. Yeah, it's a sweet spot for sure.
Yep.
So, you know, I think there's nothing I would have wanted more than to close everything out tonight. I think it's a little premature to do that. I want to have you guys have a draft approval letter if you're feeling it goes in that direction. I think there's some conditions we need to put on there. But I think everything's pretty well laid out. It's just making sure the details are there, making sure Kevin has a little bit of time to put his eyes on this. Now, knowing that Brian, somehow that the 13th letter got on versus the 16th, you know, so there's a couple little extra items on there that he's going to want to look at. And what I would like to do is I will be away starting next Tuesday for a week. So I would like to meet. I don't want to have any time go by. I would like to maybe have a Zoom meeting with Brian and George and Brendan, if that's possible. We can kind of go over everything. I'm not sure if Kevin can be there. I just want to hammer it all out, make sure it's 100% clear. One final, if there's anything left to do, one final thing comes in. And hopefully by the next meeting, we'll have a draft approval letter and we can just close everything out. So the idea that extending this process would require a granting an extension from the applicant. So we would request that this application be allowed to be extended so that if any new material needs to come in, we can have that happen between now and our July meeting. So I don't know if that's okay with you, Brendan.
Yep, that's fine.
You need me to send you an email?
Yeah, that'd be fantastic. Thank you. Thank you, Brian. And, you know, I don't think that this is going to prevent anything to be done when it comes to your enforcement order work.
Yep.
I mean, really, you need to, we've already talked about the driveway. You could do the grading on the driveway. You can stabilize the driveway. So really the only thing that's going to hang out there is your pipe. So your crossing.
Yep.
And constructing your house. So everything else should pretty much, you can get going on.
Going on, yeah. Yeah, we'll gear up and get after it.
Yeah, anything you're not sure of doing, you know, talk to George or Brian.
Yep.
So you can keep moving on the enforcement. Or one of the things I'd like to recommend as a condition when part of the permit is that none of the house construction starts. So a building permit's not issued until the enforcement order items are signed off on.
Okay.
So you can allow the piped work to start, but you know, I don't think it makes sense because otherwise you have to worry about cleaning up this enforcement order. And I'd like to just leave you, because you can put your road in. Let me know if you find any adversity to this, but I think you can get your road in, you get your road stabilized, you can even get your pipe in. We just want to make sure that all the old stuff is cleaned up before you start the new stuff. And you'll have a whole month between now and then to just really hammer down on that. And that's kind of part of constructing anyways. I don't know if that sounds reasonable, but
because,
I think.
My only question would be with, you know, filling in the pit area that we excavated from.
Mm-hmm.
I was thinking that might be a site where I bring fill from doing our foundation excavation.
Correct. And that was actually a note that I had put on these is that, you know, your steel plate removal, and that borrow pit area would be something that would be done as part of, you know, final construction.
That would be pretty much the last thing done.
Exactly. So we can leave that, you know, I can specify that in the permit approval.
Yeah.
Those two areas that get accessing that area and stabilizing that area can wait till after your construction.
Now, so I think the concern I would have, Kate, is the pipe extension and the work around there. He's going to drive cement mixers over that. We might want to do that after the foundation is poured.
Okay, whatever you guys want to do. My concern.
That's not part of the enforcement order, so that should be okay.
Okay. Right. So, you know, the pipe, you guys can go either way on the pipe.
Okay.
Because that's about your truck going over it. You know, I just want that majority of that road, both of these roads, to be stabilized, done, not eroding into things. And then, Brendan, when something goes on at the house and you got to put full attention on the house, it doesn't matter what's happening with the road. It's done.
Oh, yeah. No, 100%. Yeah, I'm with you.
Okay. So, you know, that's what I'm thinking is that, so with that allowance for the continuance, The enforcement order, you continue to move forward as everything's been presented. In terms of the application, we continue the application. I think if maybe even maybe by email tomorrow, I don't know if you guys have some time on Friday to just take a half an hour and hammer through the any notes, make sure we know exactly what we're talking about, share the screens, do the whole thing.
I might have spotty service on Friday.
That's okay. We don't need you anyways.
Okay.
Afternoon would work for me, and morning I got appointments.
Okay.
Yeah, Friday morning I have appointments also. But afternoon or over the weekend or Monday or Tuesday.
I'd like to do this. I feel like everything gets delayed on this and we don't do it till the day or the couple days before the meeting, and then it's just dragging. So I want to just pretend that there's nothing else in the world going on besides this project just for this week. So if we can meet Friday anytime afternoon is fine with me. So if we want to Zoom it, then we don't have to drive anywhere, and I think that saves us some time.
Either way is fine with me.
And if Kevin can't attend, then I can just find out what he needs to know before I talk to him. So do we want to do noon? Do we want to do later?
I'm available after 11.
I would say 12:30.
Sure.
And on. Would that work?
I'm up for anything. So 12:30 or 1 o'clock?
Fine. You want to talk to Kevin and let us know?
Sure.
All right. But I'll be available 11 to the end of the day.
Okay. I won't be available till 12. So.
Okay.
All right. So I will send you guys an email tomorrow. And then that way there won't be any loose ends. And
sure. Sounds good. The
meeting is just super clean. Yeah.
So thank you, Brendan, for extending the permit that allows us to accept additional materials while we continue the public hearing. And that'll allow Kate to address whatever else you submit and to put together a draft approval letter for the public's benefit. Anyone who may be watching this on community TV, we're not prejudging the application. The vote hasn't occurred yet, but it just makes it much easier for the commission to review the application together with all the concerns we've raised over the last several months. If we have a draft agreement available, we can go through that. We can add or subtract from conditions as the case may be, and then put it for full consideration by hopefully a quorum in July. So, all right, I think that covers everything on this application. We have a few more agenda items, I guess.
Yeah, and I would just make a formal vote to continue.
Oh, I didn't think we need one, but okay. We'll take a formal vote. Motion to, I'll entertain a motion to continue the public hearing for another, till the next regular meeting, at least.
So move.
Second.
Well, Fred was first, so Arello is second.
Right.
All right, further discussion? All in favor? Aye.
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 Nick, I heard that. Okay, unanimously, we're moving it to the next meeting. We're leaving it, the public hearing open. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
See you all night.
Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Okay. The Celtics game just started, so we really have to start moving this thing along. I didn't record it tonight. Okay, next on the agenda. And I don't really understand what number five is. I'll read it. Consideration of applications where the commissions have concluded the public hearing. What is that?
So essentially, if you close any of those public hearings and you wanted to just not deliberate at the same time, you could then deliberate later. So this allows you not to forget to have a deliberation and make a decision.
So this is a space holder in our agenda if we were making decisions on the public hearings, which... We've already made a decision on the application to amend, and we've continued the public hearing. So let's go to the next agenda item, right?
Yeah.
On this request for review, 14 Cranberry Lane, the Perez family, another property we're familiar with. What's going on?
Yeah, she's great. So now that she knows what to do, she wanted to put up, expand her driveway, just have a little turnaround area, very small, very minor. So she submitted the RFR, and I signed off on that on 5/17. So very straightforward, on the top of the hill, not down at the bottom of the slope. She's also understands that there's still a couple of shrubs and trees that need to be planted, so she'll be in contact. I'd imagine that could be any moment now that would be getting done if it isn't already. But she's been great in terms of communication now that she understands about our wetland regulations. So she's almost primed for getting on the commission now that we have a space.
Ah, there you go.
We always like to bring in the violators.
I'm not sure, you know, this year, June is a good time to plant shrubs. And, you know, it's been a really weird growing season, but.
Yeah, so I'm not sure. We'll check in with her on that.
Yeah. Okay, so next other business, agent updates. We've got a bunch of them. Do you want to just start from the top with enforcement order 123 K Street, something I think I've heard a little bit about tonight?
Yes. Or for the last 6 months. So that one, you guys know what's going on with 123 Arcade Street. I don't think I have to say anything with that. Tilcon, which is 536 Sammerbrook Street. We're just waiting for grass to grow. So at any point now, I think it's a great time to get out there. I'm going to give it a little bit more time. So probably before the next meeting, we'll be able to sign off on that in terms of final stabilization. 113 Bushy Hill, I was out there yesterday, and everything has been smoothed out. They need to go and take some of the debris so that they can plant some grass. Sounds like she's getting ready to plant the grass this week, maybe anytime in the near future, which would be really important because that's a requirement of the enforcement orders to get that stabilized. And there is no irrigation. So unless she has a lot of sprinklers, it's a really large area to cover. There is the wood chip berm that still remains in place out there. It's doing its job, and we discuss, you know, potential for removing that going through in the future once everything's stabilized. 134 Granville Road, that one there was the soil pile that's next to the water course, and I've been seeing some materials moving around out there since I've contacted them. The silt fence has gone back up. You know, they have some machines moving around out there in terms of looking like it's getting close to completion. I think they have some more time, so I'll have to check in with them personally on that, but the drive-by, you know, things are moving forward, and it's I'm just seeing attention. As 154 Granville Road, that one there where the trees were down in the back, and there was some fill placed in the wetland, some mitigation work was needed. You know, now that we're in the dry season, I assume that we should start seeing some activity on that. So I had given Sean a call in the past, the owner, and I will call him again just to confirm that his intentions for moving forward and his timeline. So those are the enforcement orders. I wanted to take a moment to introduce Renee. She's here with us. She has taken Anne Marie's position. She is fantastically organized and is very responsive so far. I'm super happy to have her on board. She's going to be taking all of our minutes, so she'll know exactly what's going on when people are calling up into town hall. She's going to hang out with us once a month every night. And so when everybody was having a hard time getting the packet, it was because it came from Renee, and she's new and nobody recognized her name. So Renee, I don't know if you want to say hi real quick or just leave that alone.
Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Oh, hi, everybody. It's Hello. Nice to meet you all. Hopefully, I'll see you in person next month. We'll see how it goes.
Just yeah. One thing, Renee, it's probably my computer. On George's and Brian's packets that were sent electronically, or at least you gave us the link, I could only get, it wouldn't download all of the, it just said, can't download all of the pages. So I only got like two pages on each one of those. So I don't know if that's something on my end or the packets are too big. I don't know. I'm just throwing it out there. Maybe we may not have to deal with this ever again. Who knows with the electronic packets, or maybe you're planning on doing that every month, which is a great way to do it. But if I have trouble next month, maybe I'll just reach out to you if that's okay.
Yeah, not a problem. I'm still, I came from a different municipality, so things were done a little differently. And I know that certain software we have is different, so the capabilities might not be the same. But yeah, if you have any problems, just let me know and I'll see what I can do for you.
So what I would like to do in relation to this is I thought everybody was hip on the OneDrive thing. It sounds like maybe we're not as hip as we thought we were. But that's really the way to get this done, because what happened is, you know, we got a plan yesterday from 123R. We got a report this afternoon. And what's nice is either Renee or I can just automatically upload things. And so they're there for us to look at least for the meeting. So I personally can't handle multiple emails. I can't keep track of things. I lose things, you know. When did that email come in? Was that that report? So what I'd like to do is try to keep this OneDrive thing. So if everybody can try to mess around with this and see how comfortable you feel, even if we do an electronic packet, I like the idea of giving this to you guys so that you have everything, even if it's submitted at the last minute and you want to take a look. And I want to reorganize the way the OneDrive is so that it's 123R Case Street, Enforcement Order, Wetlands Map Amendment, and Permit Application. And so then that way, the only thing that's in there separately is the agendas and meeting minutes, and then we just go right into the folder because it's cumulative, these applications, so you don't have to look back into like meeting dates to find things. But if you have any suggestions in terms of organization, or you really can't stand the thing, or you'd like to just have it done a different way, let's shake that out and make it as efficient as possible, because Renee is really good at efficiency. So if we let her know what we need, I think all of us together can come up with a really good, smooth system. Because right now I feel like it's not that smooth.
I think it's a great system. It's just, I'm looking at George's email on 123R case, and at the bottom there's a warning sign that says, couldn't preview file, there's a problem loading more pages. Now that may be on my end, I don't know. I don't know if anyone else had that issue, but I think I'll just see what happens next time.
I think I just want to get you guys away from getting this stuff via email.
Yeah, I think that makes a lot. It makes a lot of sense. I think that this is a really good tool. It may not be the best management tool for this. I think there's some other stuff out there that might even be better. But like to start and for the way it is now, it's like it's functional. It's better than having paper and better than having slews of emails that don't match up and you got to figure out which one is which. I mean, that's crazy. So to have it all in one place is very helpful. But there are other applications like even, I don't know if anybody's familiar with Smartsheet. I think that might be something that's like more in line with managing this kind of content. But this is like light year ahead of just emailing stuff.
Yeah, so Nick, if you don't mind, you know, forwarding Renee and I, and Abby, what these other platforms are, you think might be more appropriate. We can at least take a look into them.
Yeah, I have a couple. I might have a couple ideas. You guys can look at them. By all means, it's like up to you guys. But there's just some stuff that I use at work that was very helpful for, like, I want to say, like, I guess project management. But it's made exactly for this kind of interactive kind of file keeping and collaborative, like a collaborative workspace. But maybe the Google thing is not quite hitting all the spots. I'll send you an email with some information. I think it may be helpful.
Yeah, so I think the bottom line is, let's get everybody off of email. You know, we can get an email that has the agenda attached to it and then says, hey, guess what? We have a project where you have full-size plans or at the PD. That's if we're remote. And if we are going to a meeting, you'll just have a full packet at the PD. But we'll still keep everything on the OneDrive when it's active so that if you don't have your paper with you, you can just go onto your computer and look at something and print it out if you lose it. I think it's a nice way to just keep things clear. And then, you know, we can fine tune that as the world changes. But if there's any major opposition to that and it becomes difficult, I really want to know because I want this to work for everybody. So that's all I have.
Do you have any commissioner reports or correspondence? Hopefully not. Okay, I guess not. So that's the end of our agenda. So if someone would make a motion to adjourn, I will accept that motion.
We'll adjourn.
Nick?
Second.
Second by Arel. Further discussion?
All in favor? Aye.
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 All right, we'll see you all next month.
Good night, everybody. Bye.